Welcome again, friends. In the previous video, we have talked about the promoter sequence for tRNA. Now, in this video, we'll be talking about the promoter sequence for transcribing rRNA, right? Now, usually, for the transcription of rRNA, we require the polymerase 1 or RNA polymerase 1. So, let me write it here. So, here in case of this rRNA, we require RNA polymerase 1. Okay, and obviously we require some transcription factors because we are talking about the transcription in eukaryotic system. So we must need some transcription factors. Now in this case, the transcription factors we require are transcription factor or TF1 also, right? Now they are having different names depending upon their function, but actually they are called transcription factor 1. Now this is the structure of the promoter of tRNA. So we have talked about it. Now I'll be talking about this rRNA. Now the promoter of rRNA is again consisting of two different segments, and again the promoter is not placed in a single stretch. It is placed in multiple stretch. Okay, in two different stretches. In prokaryotes, remember, the promoter sequence always present in a single stretch. So suppose 50-60 nucleotide sequences called the promoter. So that single stretch is called promoter. But in eukaryotic system, what we know is that the promoter sequence is present in segments. Say 20 nucleotide sequence and say 30 nucleotide downstream, another 40 nucleotide sequence, both of them will be called as a complete promoter. Okay. So none of them singly consist a total promoter, but all of them will be called together as promoter. So that is the basic difference between the prokaryotic promoter as well as in eukaryotic promoter. Now in this case of rRNA promoter element, what we can see is that, so let me draw the DNA for or DNA which is having the gene for coding this rRNA segment. So if this is the DNA, there are two different segments that is consisted that is consisting this particular promoter actually. So let's say this is the DNA. And here it is another tier. So let me draw this one like that. And the desired gene of interest is present somewhere downstream. So this is the basic goal, right? We all know that the desired gene must always be present or placed downstream of the promoter. Because promoter is the start size of the transcription. And transcription has a directionality. So it must have the genes downstream of it. Otherwise, it cannot transcribe that particular gene. So here, in case of promoter of tRNA, we have seen some uniqueness that in those case that promoter element, so if this is all of these three different segment are the part of promoter element, so the promoter element is embedded somewhere inside the desired gene, so that is different, or it can be present downstream of the desired gene, so that is something different. But rest of the case, like a promoter of rRNA and mRNA, we are going to see the promoter placement resembling the type of promoter placement in prokaryotes, which is upstream of the desired gene. So this is the segment, let's say this is the desired genes, this green segment, so let me draw, this is a green desired gene segment, so let me write it here, this is the gene, and these are the two different sections. Now among these two different sections, you know, this one is called upstream control element or UCE, and this part is called the actual promoter, or actual, so let me write, let's simply write as AP, or so let me write it AP, or it is called the actual promoter segment. Okay, so this is the actual promoter, this is upstream control element. So both of them together called as promoter. That is very, very important concept. Both of them together. So we can see in prokaryotes, we mean when you talk about prokaryote, let's say if this is the prokaryotic DNA, promoter means, let's say this is the stretch of segment, this is promoter. This is the segment operator like that. So this stretch of the segment is called promoter. But in eukaryote, we are having segmented portions as a promoter. So this is the section. And both of these elements, upstream control element as well as this actual promoter region, all of them are having a very common feature of having GC repeat. GC repeats. Usually, what we can see in all the promoters or prokaryotes, we find AT repeats. Usually, we find AT repeats in all the promoters of prokaryotic system. But in case of eukaryotic system, in case of especially the promoter of rRNA, we have GC repeats, more and more GC repeats. Right? So, this is a kind of uniqueness in this case. Okay. Now, usually, it consists of AT repeats because for the transcription process, we need to open up the DNA. Now, if it is made up with more AT sequences, it is easier to open the DNA up because A and T are having two hydrogen bonds between them, right? But in this case, we are having GC, so it will require much more energy to open that up because GC is having three hydrogen bonds to pair with each other, right? Now, this is the uniqueness. Now, again, the transcription factors we utilize in this case, one of them is called UBF1. So, all of them are termed as transcription factor 1 or TF1. You can write it like that. But there are some names. UBF1. Why it is called UBF1? Because U means upstream, B means binding, F means factor. So, upstream binding factor 1, which binds to this UCE region, that's why it is termed as UBF1. Once they bind with this particular section, they will recruit another set of transcription factor, which is called, in this case, SL1. So, then SL1 will come and bind. In both case of this upstream control element as well as in this AP or actual promoter, then they will recruit this SL1. Once they are having both UBF1 and SL1 in the place, they increase the affinity of polymerase 1 to this particular place. So polymerase 1 will come and bind to this AP region, and then they will melt the DNA and start transcribing the desired gene. Now, once they start transcribing this desired gene, what it will produce? It will produce rRNA. Remember, because here we are talking about the promoter for rRNA, so after the transcription of this gene, it will produce rRNA, right? So this is the end. So once it's done, it will produce rRNA, okay? And this particular total section of this gene, it presents inside the nucleolus. Remember, rest of the parts like this tRNA or mRNA segments, they present in nucleus, right? But in this case, this section is done and totally completed, or this segment of transcription, everything occurred inside the nucleolus, which is a much more dense material found inside the nucleus, right? So this is very, very important. So that's it, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you.